motoring cliches.
So, Julia, are you ready then to strap in, buckle up, put the pedal to the metal, hit the gas, rev it, burn some rubber, and hold on to your hubcaps?
Oh, all right then.
Yeah!
On the show,
we'll be speaking to British Formula One sensation Jenson Button, plus hot new drivers Juan, Pablo, Montoya and Kimi Raikkonen.
Britain's top two rally drivers Richard Burns and Colin Mcrae are here.
I get the chance to throw the new Subaru N rally car about.
We talk to Superbike superhero Carl Fogarty.
Oval racing has landed in the UK. We look at what's in store as Champ Cars makes its debut in Britain.
There's frantic action in the Thunderdrome and lots more.
But first to a man whose name has been synonymous with Formula One since 1949. His commentating style is legendary around the world. I went to meet Murray Walker, who's finally hanging up his mic. Yes, the lips of Formula One is calling it a day. Murray Walker, what are we going to do without you?
Well, there's just as good fish in the sea as ever came out of it. It's just a question of finding them, and ITV will find someone to do my job. And I actually have a thing called a wife, which I don't see as much
on. Oh, blimey, she won't know who you are, obviously. She probably only recognises your voice down the telephone. Do you mind? Now, I hadn't heard this before, but you have a nickname, the Queen Mum of Motor Racing.
I haven't heard that one.
What do you think of that one?
No, I don't think very much of it.
That quite tickled my fancy, but I wasn't sure how you'd take to it.
No, there's lots of others, but that's a new one to me.
You've been in the business for over 50 years. You must have had a few practical jokes played on you over the years.
Doing an interview in the pit lane in America years ago, for some reason that I can't remember at the moment, I was actually standing on one of the wheeled boxes that they used for taking kit from the trucks into the garage.
You were interviewing somebody very tall, Murray? Or?
Yes, probably that was it. I was halfway through this very intense interview when two of the Lotus mechanics wheeled me away.
Now, I've got a couple of Murray myths, as we've called them here, some rumours about you that I'd just like to ask the man himself from the horse's mouth. Couple of things. You once nearly hit James Hunt, true?
Very true, yes. We were in the commentary box together. I stand up to do my commentary. He sat down. We shared one, this is a crucial point, we shared one microphone to stop us over talking each other. And I was standing up blathering away, and James had had enough of this. And he caught hold of the wire for the microphone and gave it a tug, and the microphone flew out of my hands into his. The adrenaline was pouring out of me by the bucketful, and I was incandescent with rage, this upstart interfering microphone. And I actually had my fist back to hit it. And I looked across the commentary box, and Mark Wilkin, who was the producer, was going...
My producer does that all the time. Always doing that.
So you know how it is.
Okay, so you did nearly hit him. Put the record straight. The slogan, this famous slogan, a miles a day helps you work, rest and play. Where did it come from? That
didn't come from me. I was in the advertising business from 1947 until 1982, and Mars and pet foods were one of my accounts. I had to administer it, but I didn't actually think about it. But Trill makes budgies bounce with health. An only budgie is a lonely budgie.
Murray, you know what? You went to the right profession.
I might have had something to do with those.
I've got to let you go because lots of people want to talk to you. Yeah. You're going to miss the fans, obviously.
Yes.
One thing I've always wanted to do this. I hope you don't mind. Would you like a mint, Murray? Thank you very much.
You're a star.
To actually get to be an F1 driver is, well, pretty tough. But if it's your burning ambition, bad news, I'm afraid, because it's getting tougher. The number of young drivers coming through now is unprecedented. One man, though, who looks set to be a cert is young Anthony Davidson, whose career thus far has more or less mirrored Jenson Button's. Anthony, we've just seen you in action in Formula Ford. What's actually happened since then? Where's it moved on to?
Well, yeah, after winning the Formula Ford Festival, obviously that was the greatest achievement of my racing career so far. Yeah, things are moving quite quickly, quite rapidly. Moving on into Formula 3, and the Formula 1 testing contract with VAR is a great thing, great achievement for only 1 year in single-seater motor racing.
To get inside of the head, then, of a potential F1 driver, is it the case that the Anthony Davidsons, the Jenson Buttons of this world, can cope with the pressure, and it's enormous pressure, or that you just don't notice it?
I don't really notice it that much anymore. When I first moved out of karts in Formula Ford and into motor racing, that was quite a tough challenge. But now I'm in the scene, I'm kind of learning quickly and learning, you know, how to deal with media and stuff like that. So,
all the best.
Flying Finns are nothing new to Formula One. Mika Häkkinen, Kiki Rosberg, but now there's a new one to add to the list. 21-year-old Kimi Raikkonen has signed with Sauber, but there is caution beyond the excitement. With only 23 single-seat races under his belt, he's the most inexperienced driver ever to have entered Formula One. So, Kimi, how does it feel to be putting your foot down in a Formula One car at 21?
It's feeling very nice now.
What do you say to some of the critics out there who might say that at 21, with your lack of experience at Formula One, you could be a danger to other drivers out there?
I think so. Of course, I'm doing my best and just try to do no mistakes and I don't know.
What is it about you flying fins? Is it something in the water?
No, I don't know what is it. Everybody's asking the same question always, but I don't know why is it. Finnish people are so good in the motor racing.
Well, whatever it is, I think you should bottle it. The best of luck, Kimi. Thank you.
Go-karts, it's a bit like strapping a chainsaw engine to a deck chair, isn't it, Graham? Where's the fun in these things?
Well, they do 70, 80 miles an hour. They're where, at the end of the day, most of today's Formula One drivers came from. People like Coulthard, Senna, Jenson Button, that's where they came from.
Why do we talk about it? You can't get much further from an F1 car than this.
They're different, they're smaller, but it's learning. It's from 8 years old. You're in there, you're racing, and you're going for it.
If I'd got in or near that at the age of 8, I would have just passed out, I reckon, with delight.
You might have had your name on a trophy like that, like Jenson Button.
Yeah, I suppose, if only. Too late now.
The cars here are big, brassy and powerful, and then you've got one of these. Martin, why would you race this?
Because it's got four wheels and an engine, so why not?
Is that it?
Well, it's close, it's fun, it's competitive, so let's go out and race them.
All right, show me your engine.
Here we go.
Now, you might have to get close in there, Paul, because it's a bit difficult to spot. So, how powerful is it?
Well, that's about 29 brake horsepower in there. That'll give you 85 miles an hour on 4-inch wide tyres. What more do you need?
I'm actually very surprised.
Well, be surprised. This is very close, very competitive, 24-hour racing, 2 hours at Spa. Come out and have a go with everybody else.
Don't wrap it, I'll wear it.
There's been a new trend started in recent years that I love, combining bikes and cars. You put a superbike engine in a sports car. James, you race these things. What are they like to drive?
Absolutely fantastic. For a long time now, the sports car manufacturers wanted high power outputs with minimal weight. All along, the Japanese manufacturers have got it there.
There it was, in a bike engine. Another advantage, I reckon, is they sound incredible and go like Stig. Lovely.
There is one bit of news that could have eclipsed Murray Walker's exit from Formula One, and that would have been if the UK had lost its right to host a Grand Prix. Now, it sounds ridiculous, but it was a real possibility. The waterlogged April Grand Prix of 2000, which saw fans slipping across the quagmire to reach the track, was due to be the last held at Silverstone.
It's absolutely disgusting, mate. It's a foot deep everywhere. You can't move.
But three big heads, and I mean that in the best possible way, have come together. Bernie Eccleston, owner of Formula One, Octagon, owner of British Grand Prix, and the British Drivers Racing Club, owners of Silverstone. With a whole lot of talk and a wedge full of cash, Silverstone now looks set to rise like a phoenix from the ashes and become the Grand Prix envy of the world.
What this deal means for Silverstone is firstly improved facilities, secondly improved traffic, thirdly improved spectator facilities. Tens of millions of pounds will be invested in Silverstone to take it to be one of the best Grand Prix venues, if not the best Grand Prix venue in the world. Starting in 2002, we've got a new bypass which is being installed through the northern part of our facility here by 2002. We've got a new Formula One complex planned for down here, which will make life easier for competitors and for the media and so on that come to visit. In addition to that, we're looking at various aspects of young driver development. Drivers like Jenson Button and like David Coulthard have come through the BRDC program. In this area here, which is the centre of our school, we're planning significant developments to improve the quality of young driver training. 5 years from now, we'll have the finest facility in the world, but it's not going to be overnight.
The Thunderdrome is the NEC's very own indoor racetrack. It's a tiny, tight circuit that draws thousands of fans, probably helped largely by the fact that to get through tight corners like these, the drivers have to just throw the car through, which means loads and loads of drama. Well, amongst this year's kamikaze drivers, we've got pretty much every discipline represented. NASCARs, we've got Caterhams, we've got Formula One stock cars, to name just a few. And probably at the top of the bill, the terrifying and awesome Group B rally cars. Welcome to the Thunderdrome. The noise of so many different kinds of engine outside the Thunderdrome is incredible. It's all going to kick off soon. One of motor racing's greatest legends is here, Stig Blomqvist, of course, former World Rally Champion, legend in your own right. What's it feel like to be reunited with your Audi Quattro?
Feels good. Yeah? It's nice to be back again and drive the car.
Yeah, I mean, nice isn't a word you'd really associate with this. It's a monster of a thing. Does it still feel like a monster to you?
No, okay, it is a bit of a monster, but okay, it still brings some memories back.
You're driving this year Mitsubishi Group N rally cars, absolute cutting edge modern rally cars. How does the old Quattro compare with those?
No, I think it should be, today you are quicker with a Group N car with all the developers been going on the last 15 years.
Is it as much fun?
Yeah, for sure.
You still keep your competitive edge. You've been doing this quite a while, Stig. How do you stay at the edge?
No, but if you like it and you still have fun, that's the important thing.
All right, well, look, you're going to be getting in there with these guys. Are you going to be gentle on them?
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah, all right. Okay. You're in there racing with Stig. We've got Mark and Dermot, legends in your own right, been racing for years. How's it feel getting in there racing with him?
Oh, it's pretty awesome to go against that sort of chap.
Have you raced against anybody like him before?
Never before.
Dermot, he says he might be gentle on you. I don't know.
I doubt that. He's never gentle with anybody.
Have you got any particular plan in there?
Well, either keep an eye on him or give him a help around some of the corners.
Yeah, give a playful nudge, my dear. Well, all the best to all of you. Have fun, guys. Play fair, Stig, be gentle, enjoy yourselves. I'm going to hide. First out of the blocks is Dermot with his four-wheel drive Focus. He is devastatingly quick, setting a time of 49 and a half seconds. Mark Watson was always going to be playing catch-up in his two-wheel drive. Finally, he ended up 8 whole seconds off the pace. That left it all up to Stig to topple Dermot's time. But no matter how hard the season pro pushed, he could not beat him. Was it nerve-wracking? How did you feel?
Well, I was slightly nervous going out at the start, but then once I got going and the adrenaline got going, everything seemed grand after that.
Oh, well done. You look to be enjoying yourself anyway, Dermot. Congratulations. So it's Dermot first, all the rest, including Stig, behind him. Julia.
Don't go away, because coming up after the break, we've got more news, more cars, and I'm going to be talking to a roasting new Formula One driver, the Colombian Juan Pablo Montoya.
Vampires. All Seat Ibizas have air conditioning instead of a sunroof.
Just when you think this place can't get any better. Along comes his gorgeous new Philadelphia snack. Chewy little Italian breadstickettes to dip into cool, creamy Philadelphia.
Mmm, divine.
Oh, stop! Designer halos to die for!
New Philadelphia snack, a little taste of heaven.
I just couldn't believe the effect.
Oh yeah, my cholesterol's going down.
These people aren't actors.
I've been using it for about a month now.
And it works so quickly.
They're living proof of a product that's big news down under.
It certainly lowered my cholesterol.
Tastes just like my normal margarine.
Go, Kira, go!
Clinical tests prove Flora Proactive can lower LDL cholesterol by an average of 10 to 15%.
Absolutely amazing. Like discovering a gold mine.
New Flora Proactive can dramatically cut cholesterol.
Lovely.
Stress should cause more perspiration than this.
How did she do it?
Congratulations. You're in.
Welcome back. Now, if you've got a hot new driver on the scene, then this is the place to parade him. Williams have taken the controversial decision to lease Jenson Button to Benetton for 2 years after an astonishing rookie season. But why? Well, they reckon they've got a better teammate for Ralf Schumacher. Enter onto the scene the hottest new sensation in Formula One this season, the Colombian Juan Pablo Montoya. Pablo, congratulations first of all on your move to Williams and Formula One.
Thank you.
Are you worried about being compared to Jenson throughout this season?
No. To be honest with you, no. I think Jenson did a fantastic job. But, you know, it's his job, my job is my job, so...
What's the big difference between driving Champ cars and Formula One cars for you?
Formula One car is a bit lighter, so it changes direction a lot faster. Power is a bit smoother. I think Champ has a lot of power, you know, a lot of power. So, it's a lot of fun, but I think this car is a lot of fun to drive as well.
Do you have to be slightly more cautious, do you think, in the Formula One cars?
No, you got to really push it, you know. You start thinking about being cautious, you're never really going to get to the limit of the car. And to be quick, you got to be in the limit of the car.
Alex Zardi, of course, had great success in Champ cars, moved to Formula One and Williams, and struggled a little. Can you learn anything from his experience, or do you try not to think of him at all?
Not really. I think, you know, I don't know exactly what happened to him, but, you know... So far in testing, it seems that I've been able to, you know, to get in the pace of the car. So I'm pretty pleased with that.
How'd you get on with Ralf Schumacher? Lots of rumors flying around.
Yeah, you know, I think, you know, he's a very quiet person, but, you know, he's doing his job, I'm doing mine, so it doesn't really matter.
Do you think you've got a chance? Do you think Williams have got a chance of catching Ferrari and McLaren this time?
Well, if it's not this year, it'll be next for sure. I think, you know, we're racing quite fast. You know, from the last time I drove the car to this one, it's a huge difference. The car is much better to drive. And I think, like, Michelin and BMW as well are working really hard, so it'd be quite good.
Let's move forward. It's the Grand Prix. It's Melbourne. You're sitting there on the grid. What's going through your mind?
Well, it depends how far back am I.
What position you're at?
Yeah, I think, I'm not expecting to go to the first race and put the car on pole. But I think... You know, if everything goes well, it should be a decent qualifying.
Well, we wish you good luck. Thanks a lot.
All right, thank you.
It's 1924. You're setting off cruising your high street in Missouri, where you live. You could do a lot worse than take off in one of these, a Ford Frontiac, or Fronty as those in the know called them. And it was absolutely the XR3 of its day, based as it was on the rather humble Model T Ford. Not a lot of accommodation inside, and certainly a bit breezy if you're out trying to cruise the streets on a rainy day, but plenty of warmth from the gearbox, I guess. Not that technologically advanced in its day, but enough for Anthony Moss, Sterling's father, to punt it around Brooklands in 1920. But as a boy racer in those days, not too much fun. There was no windscreen, so nothing to put your stickers on. Never mind.
Formula One made a fantastic return to the US last year, and now for the first time ever, the US Champ Cars are coming here to Britain. The Rockingham Speedway is the location of the UK's first ever oval track, and it promises to deliver some spectacular racing. Rockingham is here in a big way. Peter Davis is the managing director of Rockingham. Peter, how close is the course to completion now?
Well, we're not very far away. Our first public event is the bank holiday weekend of May, so opening ceremonies on the 26th, mm-hmm. and then the Coys International Historic Festival on the 27th and the 28th of May.
And what sort of capacity are you dealing with? What numbers are we expecting?
Well, we're building 27,500 seats. We're an all-seater stadium. That'll be the capacity that we believe will be appropriate for national racing and if you like, sort of national standard events, both racing and non-racing. Mm-hmm. And then for bigger events, the Champ Car FedEx World Series in September, then temporary seats will be provided on a required basis.
Well, now over here I've got Dan Wheldon, the Rookie of the Year from last year's Champ Car Lights competition. What's it like to race in America and race the oval?
Actually, it's something that is very, very different, but once you actually get used to it, it's a fantastic... A fantastic thrill.
Now, you've taken to this incredibly well, winning the Oval Crown Championship. It's obviously a sport that you enjoy tremendously and excites you.
Yes, I mean, I've always been brought up in motor racing. My dad actually raced karts. So I was karting from the age of four. And then I've just gradually progressed through the ranks up into single-seaters and made the stateside move in 1999 in the USF 2000 series. And that went fantastic. I mean, I won the overall title, the Road to Indy Oval Crown Championship and the Rookie of the Year, and then followed that up last year with second overall in the championship and Rookie of the Year again, which is great.
It's not just Champ Cars that race the oval. Rick Pedrizzi races these monsters, NASCARs. Rick, it must be pretty frightening in there.
I don't know about frightening. It's fun. Definitely fun. These cars, Winston Cup cars, 3,400-pound race cars that probably when you look at them the first time, may not look too impressive or too high-tech. You get them out on the racetrack and get them up to speed, you'll have a different viewpoint from there.
John Cleland, British touring maestro. Next season you're going to be in ASCARs. So we've gone from Champ Cars and NASCARs to ASCARs. I'm doing everything in rhyme. Explain the difference.
Well, the difference is an ASCAR that runs to the UK specification is a little bit lighter with a little bit less power than a Winston Cup car, but still spectacularly enough to do 180-odd miles an hour and very noisy, and just, I think it's going to be great racing.
Only 180, old John.
Well, that's, I think that's quick enough.
I think so too. And you've got a couple of the AS cars going to be racing in the Thunderdrome.
Yeah, we certainly have.
And out here, these guys are getting ready to kick it.
Thunderdrome, we've got a Guinness World Record holder, Russ Swift. Now, Russ, the stuff that you do, it looks like every car's worst nightmare. What is it? Precision driving, stunt driving?
Pure abuse.
And the basic kind of manoeuvres we're talking about, what are they?
Handbrake turn, yeah. Reverse spin.
You know when you get a new stunt and you decide, right, this is the one I'm going to do? What happens the first time you try it?
You normally crash.
I just wanted to know that because you're going to take me around and we're going to do some of this.
Right, well, we won't do anything new this time.
Right, might not be new to you, it's going to be new to me, I can tell you that much. Right, here we go then. Horton says don't try this at home, or if you do, use your mum's car. I don't mean that really. Go on then, do it. This is good for it. Oh my word. Are you any good at going in a straight line? Oh my god. Cheers, Russ. I think I'll walk. God.
Ray Mallock has been a champion driver, a team boss and a designer. Now he's uniting all of those skills to launch an attack on Le Mans for the first time in more than a decade. And this is his assault weapon. It's beautiful, isn't it? Like the Batmobile. Let's turn back the clock 10 years or more than 10 years ago when you were driving for Le Mans in an Aston Martin back then. What's been happening since?
Well, my company, RML, moved from sports car racing into touring car racing.
So why the return to endurance? What's the love affair with Le Mans?
Sports car racing and Le Mans in particular has always been in my blood. I raced there 9 times as a driver and didn't win there, came second in class, was the best ever. But it's unfinished business as far as Ray Mallock and RML are concerned. We have to build a road going version as well as the race version.
So they're available out there for people to buy?
They'll be available
like
from July onwards, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you're seriously expecting a class win at Le Mans?
I've seen no reason why not, yeah. We need to get some more miles under our belts to improve the reliability, but the speed's definitely there.
And you will obviously be back in the driver's seat.
I'm going to get in there and do some testing, yeah.
But who'll be driving at Le Mans for you?
That's not settled yet. Still in negotiation with drivers and sponsors.
I think you should make a return, Ray. Thanks a lot. Good luck with everything.
Thank you.
Join us after the break for a whole pit lane full of motor racing stars. We'll have Pedro de la Rosa, Jenson Button, Colin Mcrae, Carl Fogarty, Jamie Whitham, the F1 review. Julia goes rally driving and we meet some of the glamour girls from the show. See you in a couple of minutes.
Citroën Zara Picasso. Free your mind.
First, peel yourself off sofa and squeeze into the kitchen. Fry onions in a little oil and add mince. While mince is frying, stuff specialist magazines under sofa and briskly whip Y fronts off radiator. Return to oven and crumble OXO cube into mince to really add depth to the flavour. Add contents of larder and simmer until doorbell. Turn charm up to maximum and serve.
This looks so nice.
Just as soon as you've finished your starters. Just add OXO.
How can you make the sun shine on a rainy day? Get a free holiday planning video for the Walt Disney World Resort in Florida. Just call 08705-00001 and we'll send you a preview of the magic. You'll find out how to stay at a Disney resort, where to have breakfast with Mickey Mouse, how to get into the parks early, and more. The video makes planning your holiday easy. So call now before we run out and discover the magic inside.
Call Vigil cell phones now on 0500-000-1-1. Order any free mobile phone with free connections to 1-to-1 and you could win an all-expenses-paid holiday for two to a tropical paradise. You could order the cool Nokia 3310. But whichever phone you choose, it'll come with a free t-shirt. Hiya, Mom. No. Blow a few wolves around.
How far can you get on 5P? Well, call this number and ask NTL how you can talk to friends and family in Australia, Canada, France and Germany, Hong Kong, New Zealand, and America for just 5p a minute. Around the world, day or night, for just 5p a minute. There must be someone I know out there.
Call free on 0500 500 500 and ask about our international call option.
Excuse me. I'm looking for some help with my pension options. I understand I can find it here.
Looking for an impartial guide to your pension options? Visit our website.
Sorry, mate. You got the wrong kind of web.
Remember MC Hammer? Remember the dance? Or remember the day when England met France? Remember the crop circles? Remember when some of us thought it was little green men? Remember the pandas trying to mate? Or the Hubble telescope got in a state? Remember when Gaza started to cry? Or when Waddle kissed England's World Cup goodbye? Remember 1990? Remember the time when a Mac chicken sandwich was just £1.39? £1.39, a price from the past. Back at McDonald's while stocks last.
Welcome back to the Autosport International 2001 here at the NEC in Birmingham. Now, unless you're lucky enough to be one of the incredibly select and glamorous few who get to go just about anywhere they want, then getting access to the F1 pit lane might prove just a little bit tricky. But not here at the NEC, because here the F1 pit lanes are open to absolutely everybody. The barriers are down. Time now to catch up on a preview for this year's F1 racing season.
Last year, Mika Häkkinen, in his beautifully understated way, described his car as...
Quite a fast car, quite a rocket.
But it wasn't quite enough of a rocket to stop Michael Schumacher getting his first championship title for Ferrari, much to the delight of prancing horse fans around the world. However, even though McLaren had three disastrous opening races, they fought back hard, narrowing the gap. So Ferrari certainly shouldn't rely on McLaren having another poor start this season.
Life starts to get a lot more interesting when you look at who's chasing the big two. Williams are catching up fast. The first crack started to appear with Ralf Schumacher. Partnered with Zanardi, Ralf reigned supreme. But in qualifying last season against Button, the pressure really was on. He's had a few more bad days than he ought to have had, was how Williams put it. So how will he fare against Montoya? Well, either way, we know the car is going to be fast.
As for Jaguar, last season is better best forgotten. Say goodbye to the ever unlucky Johnny Herbert and hello to last year's test driver Luciano Berti, who replaces him. The biggest change, however, is the introduction of a new man at the top. He's one of the few successful drivers to become a successful team boss. It is Bobby Rahal. But what's he going to do to turn Jaguar around?
Well, I think get the right people in the right places doing the right things. It's not going to be easy, but to be sure, but I think the steps are being taken to head down the right direction.
Do you think your experience as a driver helps you now to be a good team boss?
Well, I think for the drivers, it gives them, I think they understand that I understand what goes on. And I think that gives them some comfort. At the same token, I know stories when I hear them, so they can't... They can't fool me.
This is the last year for Benetton, their swan song, because in 2002 they become Renault Sport. They're using new Renault engines this year, so it might prove difficult to make an impression. Jenson Button versus the once much fancied Fisichella is the battle to watch.
One of the most interesting clashes of the season will be BAR versus Jordan. Both have Honda engines and both have highly rated drivers. Jacques Villeneuve teams up with Olivier Panis for BAR, and Jordan stick with Frentzen and Trulli. We spoke to Craig Pollock and found out what he thought about the competition.
I wouldn't put Jordan as ourselves today in at the level of a McLaren and a Ferrari. I think and I strongly have to believe that British American Racing will now get there earlier than Jordan, because we believe that we will beat Jordan this year.
Craig is throwing down a challenge to Jordan then, but with the new state-of-the-art Honda engines, Jordan's engineers could have exactly what they need to shake away last year's blues and bounce back into contention.
So, can Arrows keep up the good work? Well, it's going to be tough, having lost their designer Egbel Hamady to Jordan and running an as-yet unknown ex-Peugeot AMT engine. Still, Pedro de la Rosa seemed reasonably upbeat when I caught up with him.
The team knows and wants to improve the seventh position in the Constructors' Championship, because that's what we have to do, just improve. It will be difficult, because nowadays, now in January, everyone is talking how good their new car will be and how much they have improved, and so are we.
Minardi have had their setbacks getting the right package together. Prost have opted for a Ferrari engine, which could reap dividends, and Sauber may be relying too heavily on two very young drivers, though that's no bad thing in my book.
As essential as the gorgeous machinery in motor racing, another tradition has always been the gorgeous girls.
Men are interested in motorsports and women attract men.
they've got no shame about just coming up to you and asking you for photos.
Do they, really?
Yeah. And I haven't seen one decent man here in the whole of the show.
If you're in motorsport, then you need to travel. And what you don't want to do is pitch a grubby little tent up in a grubby little muddy field. What you do want is a classy motorhome like this. It's got leather seats, it's got a video player, it's got a television, it's actually got everything, including plastic fruit and a sand glass blasted chess set. Seriously though, if the diminishing rainforest doesn't worry your conscience, this is for you. Look at this double fronted fridge, and there's more in there than I've got at home. Moving through to your lovely ensuite shower room. This is my favourite feature. You get a man in with the bargain as well. Ross, how much will this cost you?
Travel World charges a very reasonable price of £175,000.
I think I'm going to work on the discount.
Jason Rennie. Do you know the name? Well, you should do, because he's a world record holder. Jason, a world record holder at what?
Well, the longest motorcycle jump in history.
Yeah, now it's 253 feet. That's incredible.
Yeah, that's nearly goalpost to goalpost, actually, on a football.
That is truly astounding. Look, we can have a look at this now. You can actually talk us through it. So let's have a look at what you did. Talk us through what happened.
On the run-up, you're just praying that you've got enough speed.
What sort of speed is it?
About 95 mile an hour. Halfway through the air, you realise whether you've got enough speed or not. And when you land, it's just a brilliant feeling.
Well, look, everybody's going to say Evel Knievel. Is there a link there? You're going to be the new Evel Knievel?
I believe the time is right now to have an era like Evel Knievel had 25 years ago. I believe everything's gone full circle. Jumping's coming back in on BMX bikes and all this lot now, and I believe we can be as big, if not bigger, than what Evel Knievel was 25 years ago.
Well, we're going to keep a lookout for the name Jason Rennie.
For the first time this year, the exhibition has opened its doors to the world of bikes. And who better to get things started than the superbike superhero, Carl Fogarty? Carl Fogarty, four-time world champion. You must be living it up in Monte Carlo or Florida or something by now.
Sunny Blackburn.
Sunny Blackburn. Yeah, if we can, let's just try and remember the accident for a moment that preceded your retirement. What can you remember about it?
Nothing. That's the one of the frustrating things about it. I remember starting the second race, and that is all. Honestly, it's incredible. All the years I've been racing, I've never been knocked out. I've remembered every single crash I've ever had. The one that finished me off, I have no memory of it whatsoever.
So a mystery hangs over the whole incident,
yeah,
really?
Yeah, because there were no cameras, no like cameras showing me body what happens to it.
You were saying earlier that now when you get on a bike, you can't lower your elbow properly.
Yeah,
it feels a bit strange.
Because the position you're in, my arm won't go in that position anymore. So it's incredible that, you know, I've sort of got an injury that just won't allow me to get in a position to race a bike anymore, never mind ride one properly. So.
What do you think of some of the new drivers coming up, Neil Hodgson and Chris Walker?
It seems funny talking about them as new riders, because yeah. I've been, you know, I mean, Neil was my teammate about 4 years ago and stuff. But yeah, they both had a very good 2,000 years. You know, I got injured and they both sort of stepped forward and sort of carried on, if you like, and both had great years. And I think if they can both carry it through to this year, then they'll have good years.
When you look at the biking pack now, is there anybody you see out there who's got the same glint in their eye?
No, not the same, no, they don't. They all want to be out there for sure, but I can't see anyone's eye that they want to win as battle as what I did, no.
The British Superbike Championship went right down to the wire last season. It all ended up in the last meet of the season at Donington, and Chris Walker was the unlucky guy who lost it all when the bike blew up on the final race. That walk back to the pits after that, got to be a long walk. What goes through your mind?
I was actually not too bad when the bike initially stopped. I was, you know, obviously I didn't really know what to think. I was just, everything was flashing through my mind, but then when I got off the bike and everybody started clapping and cheering, and I did have a few tears in my eyes.
Things have picked up a lot since then, so what's on the cards now?
Fortunately, I've got a 2-year deal, so I've got a bit of time to, without too much pressure on me initially, so I can learn to walk before I have to run, sort of thing. But no, it's going to be a massive step forward for me, but you know, I'm looking forward to the challenge, and that's probably what's making it so exciting.
Well, I'm here with Neil Hodgson, the British Superbike champion. Nearly must be very excited. What was it like winning at Donington?
Just incredible, you know. It was a dream come true for me. I didn't think I was going to win, to be honest. It went down to the last round. I had a lot of luck on my side, thank God, and I won it. So I'm pleased. It's made the last few months nice. You know, I've come to these shows as the champion.
And any thoughts for Chris Walker? He was pretty gutted.
Well, at the time, I didn't feel for him, obviously, because he was my main rival, and there was a lot of rivalry there between us. And I did feel for him when I saw his reaction, but that's racing. There's winners and losers, and I was very, very lucky, and he had a lot of bad luck.
And your plans for next year?
Well, I'm doing a full season of World Superbike, so I'm really excited about that. Hopefully, my aim for the year is to be a regular top three man.
Well, you're certainly the champion for the course. Good luck next season. I hope it all goes well for you.
Thank you very
Thanks
much.
Thanks very much, Neil. Thanks. And now I'm sure there are a few more world-class bikers in the Thunderdrome.
Thanks, Julia. We're backstage here at the Thunderdrome where it is getting very loud and leery. Not these guys, of course. They've been very well behaved, considering that they're all biking legends. We've got, first of all, James Whitham. James, just briefly while we've got you, you are known for just being the comeback kid. You were desperately unwell. You came back from that. You had an horrendous accident. You came back from that. What makes you so unstoppable?
I can't do anything else for a living. I've got to keep going.
Nothing else you can do. Has it made you stronger, though, as a rider and as a person? It must have done.
Oh, yeah, it's all part of the rich tapestry of life.
Yeah, I think people say it's character building.
That's just still.
That's one way of doing it, yeah. James. We'll keep watching out for you, James. Thanks a lot. Over here, we've got Sean. Now, Sean, you have been let down in the past by the kit, by the equipment, by the bike. That must be gutting.
Yeah, well, that's true. You can only do stuff with what you've been given, so it's like asking Tiger Woods to play a plastic club sometimes. But
yeah, it's not going to work, is it? Really?
No, it is. No.
But you're back with Ducati now,
yeah,
very
well,
happy.
I've got the right stuff now, and it's down to me now.
Looking forward to seeing something good from you, British Superbikes.
Yeah, thanks very much.
Excellent.
Can't wait. Yeah.
Cheers, thank you. That's Sean Emmett. On the end, we've got John Reynolds. John, you're known for being Mr. Consistent every time, into perfect. How do you do that? What's the secret?
Well, the secret is just basically having a good bike, a good setup, and a good team behind you.
How valuable is it being able to go out and do the same thing time and time again?
It's vital. I mean, if you want to win races, you've basically got to do lap after lap consistently fast. So,
well, all the best in the coming season. We'll
thank you.
Cheers, John. Let's talk over here finally to John. Now, I know none of these guys are good at these things. This is a bike with four wheels, a quad. Everyone says they're horribly dangerous, are they?
Yeah, they are quite.
Nice. Yeah. Sensible man. All the best. We'll keep an eye out for you. Hopefully, us talking to you won't jinx him. We'll see how he does. Right, well, that was quite a race, so let's get in here and catch it with Sean and see how we did. Sean, you've won every one so far.
Yeah, I never won that one.
No,
that was
what happened?
Great. I was beaten by the young whippersnapper.
Yeah, bad luck. The young whippersnapper here, who is called Jonathan Young, very apt because you are 17 years old, but you've been doing this for some time.
Yeah, I've been racing. Well, I've been practicing in quad since I was 10, then started racing last year when I turned 16.
And you've got a nasty habit of winning all the time. Ever thought of two wheels, or has it got to be four?
Tried to free wheel, but no, it's got it before.
Well, I know this is a growing sport. We're going to see more of it, and I've got a feeling we're going to see more of you. Well done today. And poor Sean. Never mind. Beaten by the whippersnapper.
Well, whatever you do, don't go away, because right after the break, I'm going to be talking to British driving sensation Jenson Button and two top British rally drivers, Richard Burns and Colin Mcrae. Plus, you get to see how a certain type of girl given the right piece of machinery can impress the boys.
As a loving parent, you wouldn't put your child in unnecessary danger. Childhood diseases can be very serious, so it's important to immunize. If your child is under 18 and still hasn't been immunized against meningitis C, please contact your surgery or clinic.
With this Pilates body control video and book offer from Kellogg's Special K, it's now easier to improve your muscle tone. Posture. Coordination. Pilates body control video and book offer from Kellogg Special K. Stay special.
It's so easy to move your mortgage to Intelligent Finance. And if you connect it with an Intelligent Finance current account, you could pay no interest on part of your mortgage. This is one of the many ways you could be better off with Intelligent Finance. Just by connecting the money you have with the money you borrow. Intelligent Finance, the new bank from the Halifax. Call now on 0845 600 4343 or apply online at if. autosport.com.
شنو تعملي الليلة؟
شو رأيك بالأفلام؟
تمام.
I'm singing in the rain, just singing in the rain. What a glorious.
Whatever the future holds, the future takes Visa.
Round, round, get around, I get around.
What's stopping you experience fabulous places? What's stopping you take great value holidays? What's stopping you try new holiday activities? What's stopping you take holidays where you explore your own potential? With extraordinary levels of customer satisfaction year after year, there really is nothing to stop you taking a Saga holiday.
Imagine a world where everything is protected. The new look Citroën Zara is available with 6 airbags, variable power-assisted steering, and ABS with electronic brake force distribution. Travel in a safer world.
Sorry to drag you in here on a Sunday. 2 hours and 17 minutes ago, our system went down.
Right now, we're losing close to 100,000 an hour.
I talked to the server vendor. They say it's an application problem.
Front-end guy says it's database.
Database vendor says it's the servers.
Did you call the web designers?
Snowboarding.
And whose job is it to make sure all this stuff works the way it's supposed to?
That would be yours.
And that's when it hits you. You're ready for IBM.
Difference a year makes. This time last year, Jenson Button was virtually unknown. Williams had terminated their contract with Zanardi, and the Brazilian Bruno Quinquiria looks set to become their number two driver. After performing well in a one-off test drive for Prost, Jenson was then given the opportunity to test for Williams in Jerez, and he hasn't looked back since. So has the British public warmed to Jenson? Just a lot. Jenson, does testing for Williams in Jerez seem like a lifetime ago now?
It does. I mean, it's only been a year, but in different ways. I mean, this last year went by so quickly. I mean, you're racing every other weekend. But then again, on the other side, so much has changed over a whole year, a whole season, just not just at the races, but away from the circuit as well.
Your whole lifestyle.
Yeah, but in for the better, definitely.
Now, you're known as a nice guy, but you've had your fair share of run-ins already on the circuit with Jarno Trulli in Indianapolis and at the Spa. Is this an inkling of things to come? How far are you prepared to go?
Well, I think next year I'll be pushing. This year, sorry, 2001, I'll be pushing harder than I was last year. But no, I don't want to crash. No, definitely I don't want to have any coming together with other drivers. But this year I'm going to push to the limit, where last year I was a bit more cautious.
Mm-hmm.
Every race last year. We'll see. I mean, you don't want to crash, but we'll see. It's going to be a tough year. I think a lot of the teams are going to be on the same level, so there's going to be a lot of good racing, hopefully, with the difference in the aerodynamics.
And you're going to be getting on in there.
Yeah, definitely.
Now, Jarno, of course, is due to come back to Renault Sport in 2002. How do you think you'd get on as teammates?
I think we'd get on well. I mean, we speak now and everything, and we get on fine. It's just one of those things on the circuit. It just happens now and again, of coming together, but we'll get on fine, I'm sure, if that did happen.
Speaking of teammates, you pushed Ralf Schumacher hard last year. Do you think you can push Fisichella as hard this year?
Well, I hope so. I hope so. Hopefully harder. But I think he's a very good teammate. We've worked well together already in testing. And he's actually good fun as well, which is a big bonus. I think hopefully we can work very well together and push each other to the limit. So then it pulls the whole team with it. And that's when you get good finishes.
Now, obviously, you're with Benetton for two seasons. What would it be like for you if you have to leave just as they're perfecting the new wide-angle V10 engine?
It's something, I suppose, that if it happens, it's got to happen. You can't change anything, so that's the same thing that's happened with Williams and Benetton this year.
Changing of teams is just like changing a job, really. It's got to happen sometimes. And I don't know, we'll see. I'm sure Benetton are going to be good for the next 2 years. I'm really looking forward to working with them. And then what happens after that, it's, I don't know, we'll see.
If you could, say, move forward 5 years, where would you like to be? What do you want to be doing?
I'd like to be world champion.
Well, we hope that you do well anyway for the next season. Thanks a lot, Jenson Button. Thank you.
It's become kind of a tradition for racing drivers to have their crash helmets decorated. Jason, you've been doing that for, what, 10, 15 years? Why?
Well, these days, the sponsors have such a lot of control over the team's image, from the pit crew overalls right to the car. The helmet's the last place the driver can be an individual.
Well, they're expressing their individuality. Are they a creative and artistic bunch?
Yeah, quite a lot of them are. A lot of them know exactly what they want. It's the only place where they can be individual, so they want to get it exactly right.
Well, keep up the good work. At least it adds some serious colour and design to motorsport. Some of these are absolutely balmy designs, but great.
Ah, oh, just what I need, a nice brake. But Joe, these are no ordinary brakes, are they?
No, these are brakes manufactured for racing. These sort of brakes are here will stop Jenson Button, Mika Häkkinen in this year's Formula One season, and basically all the other top racing series throughout the world.
But the story doesn't end there, because there's something very exciting for us, the ordinary punter now in the braking world. Tell me about this little baby.
This brake is basically produced from racing technology and will provide the user to stop 20-30% quicker, more efficiently than he would do with his normal standard brakes.
Well, you don't need to say any more than that, do you? Let's just put a halt to it now.
Not everything here can be about going blisteringly fast. Some of them are a little more sedate. Ian Wright's company builds these things and he competes in them. What is it?
It's a sporting trials car. Its only purpose in life is going up steep, muddy hills that mountain goats usually
go. How steep are we talking? Show me.
We're talking 50 and 60% slopes. Seriously,
what
steep.
What kind of speed? Flat out?
Oh, only 25 miles now, I'm afraid.
Now, you're a British champion at this, so we should be good. This is one where I bounce up and down, isn't
it? Yep, bouncing.
Right, I'm going to bounce.
Yep, bouncing gives attraction.
I'm frightened. Okay.
Last season's World Rally Championship was one of the most closely fought battles in a long time. The popularity of rally is growing every year. And when you see them in action, not surprising. This is the new Subaru Group N Impreza. Basically, it's one step down from a World Rally car. But rather than just gawp at it, I decided to take it for a spin. Who better to give me some top tips before I get behind the wheel than former British champion David Higgins. David, hello. So as an ordinary punter, is there anything I should watch out for specifically?
Treat it with respect to start with and then get some confidence with the car and then you'll be fine, you'll start to really enjoy it.
Now you are going to treat me softly first time round.
I'll try to.
Come on then. So this seatbelt seems to strap in from every angle.
Yeah.
There really is no escape. If I scream really loudly, I'll probably pierce your eardrum.
I'll just go faster, it's okay. It's not going to be too scary, is it?
That's lovely, I just love it. Whoa! Now, what sort of speed are we doing as we enter the corners here?
Now, we're up to like 60, 70 miles an hour.
I tell you what, it feels a lot faster. And the brakes are very sensitive.
You have to be quite aggressive with them, really. So you probably need about three times the amount of pressure you'd use in your road car, really.
Right.
I think we should be getting quite near to your turn now.
Great. Final words of advice?
Hold on and enjoy it.
Right. Now it's your turn. Okay, here we go. Now, David, if I was to crash this car,
I'd be in trouble.
It's incredibly physically draining. Difficult to keep your hands still. What I'm not doing very successfully is changing gears.
No.
Because I'm finding it quite difficult to concentrate on what I'm doing now.
That's good. Very good. You're a natural. You passed the test.
Towards the end there, you really get into it, some nice power slides, and really starting to get into the car, and I was quite impressed.
Marks out of 10?
It was very good, probably 7.5 out of 10.
Whoa! So you'd have me as part of your team?
Yeah, a bit more muscle in the right foot for the brake pedal and you'll be fine.
I'll sort out the muscle. Sponsors, I'm waiting.
At the top level of rallying, Colin Mcrae has been plying his trade for 2 years with Ford. But it could all have come to a nasty end with a very serious accident in Corsica last season. I caught up with him and his co-driver, Nicky Grist. guys, big highlight, or probably one you don't want to remember, the crash in Corsica. Could be said you were lucky to get away with what was a broken cheekbone, but I don't know if that really is lucky, but I suppose you must have been. Did you feel it?
Didn't feel a thing. Well, I was knocked out, luckily, so, you know, the best way to be in a situation like that.
I mean, accidents fall into different categories, I suppose. Unlucky, mistakes. This one, where would you put it? What happened?
Okay, you could say unlucky. I mean, it wasn't a fast accident. It was relatively slow. It was just unlucky that there was a hole in the wall at that point and we went through it.
And your feelings now as you look ahead?
Looking good. It's going really well all through the winter testing. It's been good. The car feels good. I'm happy. We just have to get on with the competition now.
Some people are saying that the cars are becoming more and more technologically advanced, kind of levelling the playing field as far as the machinery is concerned, and that puts the emphasis back on the human element, on the driver and on the co-driver.
It puts the emphasis, not so much, okay, the emphasis in rallying is always on the crew, the driver, navigator.
Well, the human element then, does the emphasis on the skill come back on the human element, rather than the machinery?
It still comes back in the human element for sure, but it puts a lot more emphasis on engineering and budgets and, you know, and having the right team of people behind us.
Second in the championship to new boy Marcus Gronholm is Richard Burns, who was pushing hard all the way to the end. Now, having had a taste of rallying for myself, I was keen to meet the man who drives the World Rally Spec Impreza for a living. Richard, it's nice to meet you. Tell me what you thought of the Impreza last season, because there are a couple of question marks over its reliability.
Yeah, they were sort of in the middle of the season, because what happened was after the first three rallies, we got basically a brand new car, even though it looked very similar. Under the skin, it was something like 90% new. So after the first three rallies, everybody was pretty confident. We won two of them, finished second in the other one. So obviously hopes were pretty high for the rest of the year, but then things started to go wrong a little bit. It always happens when you have a new car. The car had put the level of performance on gravel considerably out of reach of the other teams at that time, and unfortunately it was maybe, I don't think it was too far, you know, but these things happen with new cars. It's happened with the Ford before and with the Peugeot. And unfortunately, because the car looked the same, everybody thought the worst.
It was incredibly hard fought last season. I mean, statistically, you set almost twice as many fastest stage times as any other driver. Do you feel slightly cheated out of the title?
It's a bit frustrating, but it's also nice to know that you're the fastest person out there, you know. I think also over the whole 14 rallies last year, we were the only ones who set fastest times in every single rally. So, you know, I haven't got the cup, I haven't got the crown, I haven't got the award or whatever, but I do have the feeling and the knowledge that when everything goes right, then we can win.
What will you be focusing on then this coming season?
Winning every single rally I can. It's as simple as that. Every rally I start, I want to win.
Do you feel the pressure of expectations on your shoulders for 2001, or is it more excitement?
It's a bit of everything, because I mean there's pressure throughout the whole season. You always feel pressure doing this kind of job, the sport at this kind of level. There's bound to be some pressure, some expectation, but the best thing I can do is forget about all that and just concentrate on my driving, which is what will help me win the championship.
Oh, Richard, I'm sure you will. Thanks very much, and have a safe flight back to Barcelona.
Cheers.
Richard Burns. Well, of course, Colin and Richard will be looking out for last season's new boy, Marcus Gronholm, who crept up the table almost unnoticed and stole the championship.
And you should never write off four times world champion Tommy Mäkinen, who's just become the third man in history to win a hat-trick of Monte Carlo rallies.
Even with a big budget, rumoured to be bigger than Ford's, and the talent of 94 world champion Auriel, couldn't get their campaign together and have decided to pull out of next season.
The action here in the Thunderdome has been incredible, with some seriously awesome machinery on display. Yeah, well, not just this, obviously. There's been all this.
Up this ramp, fly through the air.
Well, that's it from us, but don't forget that the rally season is already underway.
And that Formula One, Formula Three and Champ Cars all kick off in March.
And the first ever Champ Car race in the UK happens in September.
That's it from us at the NEC. Goodbye and thanks for watching.
Bye-bye.
We meet up with the Air Squadron cadets in High Flyers next.